When you think of 1993, what kind of game springs to mind? If you're anything like me, probably Doom. Or Duke Nukem. Commander Keen, maybe. Either way, you're definitely not thinking of this one. 1993 was a time of some brilliant releases for the PC if you were the type to hang out on old BBS sites. A possibly overlooked title, however, is the one we're going to look at today, Gateworld by Homebrew Software. Before 1992, Homebrew Software didn't even exist yet. In fact, the two big names of Homebrew, Ken Rogoway and Dan Farquharson, used to work for Epix. Between the two of them, they worked on versions of California Games, Defender of the Crown, Rescue on Fractalus, and Coronis Rift. If none of those sound familiar to you, you may also have heard of a slightly more infamous title of theirs, which was released under the Homebrew name, Rollo Gump. But back on topic to Gateworld. Gateworld is a pretty basic side-scrolling platformer that seems to do nearly everything wrong. The first level is filled with traps that will instantly kill even the wariest of players, power-ups which aren't even mentioned in the README file, and a gap that's nearly impossible to jump, but must be crossed to exit said level. Anyway, let's move on and see what the deal is with this game. So as you can see, this is an old DOS game, can only be run through DOSBox. I would like to point out, though, that the company that made this game, Homebrew Software, that's actually the name of the company, they are still alive. They're not making games anymore, but they actually do have this for sale on their website. And if anybody really, 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 really wants to buy this game after watching this, I will provide the website for people who would like to buy it. That
said... And I would like to add, what the heck is wrong with you?
No. Well, we don't judge. We're just going to present it as is. So, let's get this started. So here we are, Gateworld by Homebrew Software.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to ask, is this the first time anybody has used the term homebrew in this game, or was that something that happened before?
Homebrew has actually been around as a term since, I think, Prohibition era, if not earlier.
Okay.
Because they used to refer to brewing beer, like moonshining, or bathtubs and the like.
There it goes.
Bathtub gin.
Yeah, brewing your own beer in a bathtub.
So I'd like to say a little trivia about this game real quick.
Sure.
Apparently it's either going to be published or developed by Apogee, but apparently they just kind of gave up on them. They just didn't want it anymore. They just kind of like... just said, screw it, you can have this to Homebrew Software, and now we have this. I know Apogee's involved with this game at some point, I just don't know how.
Now, do you think that's because of the rising popularity of Wolfenstein and Doom-like games, or...?
I would just say they probably just thought it looked like it was awful.
According to the official Apogee FAQ, which is hosted on Ringworks.com, Gateworld was slated for a February of 1991 release under Apogee and was cancelled due to poor quality, and later released by Homebrew Software 2 years later.
Look at this dude's eyes.
So they actually did get a good look at it then.
Yeah, and Apogee decided they wanted nothing to do with it. This was even prior to their making... or prior to their publishing Wolfenstein 3D. That wouldn't happen for another year.
I was just kind of wondering because of the 1993, so I guess they just decided to publish it on their own, or...
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's what ended up happening. What's interesting, too, and we'll get into this later when I actually get to that one, I want you guys to pay close attention to the intro, too, because you're going to see that again when we do the CD version. And you will see they didn't really do a very good job of improving it. But here's the interesting thing to note. Most of the music in this game is horribly broken.
Yeah, I have no idea what's going on, but it's not supposed to sound all creepy, echoey like that, and like atonal. I was speaking about it with a friend of mine in the Doom community. He looked at the MIDI files and determined that whatever they'd saved them under had actually corrupted them. So there's no way to actually extract the undestroyed song.
And here we see the first death of the game, and a cheap one it is. So yeah, these little ramps bounce you up and down, but where that one is positioned, it literally catapults you right into that stupid spike.
Fortunately, that area is completely optional.
No, it's not actually, because right to the right of that's the key you need to unlock the exit.
Oh. Oh, shoot. Dude.
Yeah. Can we say quality?
You have a health bar, but a lot of things in this game will basically instantly kill you for no particular reason, so...
Yeah, like those spikes. Stalactites.
Now, do you have different death scenes, like in Dangerous Dave, or...?
Nope.
Doesn't matter what kills you, your head explodes. Even if you land on spikes, it just happened there.
Yeah, that's actually one thing I do like about this game is the character sprite. He just has this constant look of like, I don't know if I really want to be here.
I thought it was a dopey grin, but it's kind of hard to tell at that resolution.
Honestly, it could be either. Yeah, it could be like the heroic grin or...
On a different note, what was the shareware game fascination with constantly grinning, blonde-haired, blue-eyed, like, muscled guys for protagonists? Because, I mean, between this guy and Duke Nukem and the guy from Secret Agent Man, 006 and a half, I want to say his name was.
That's true.
Probably the same thing as with, like, you know, action movie heroes and stuff like that.
And, like, Jason Storm in Space Chase, I think, is another one of those.
God.
The only people that didn't do that were Epic Mega Games, and only then because they made a girl instead.
But
she was blonde.
Yes, she was. Even though she was supposed to be of the jungle.
Well, I was going to say, you know, like, there's this whole Aryan thing going on, except for maybe BJ Blazkowicz, but, you know, I'm not going to go into that. sorry.
Yeah, but he's half Polish, though.
This is big old Pole guy.
So I want to point out these little eye dudes, the blue things, they're really interesting because they're technically enemies, like, you can kill them. But they actually both serve a purpose and a pain in the ass. It's interesting because you can actually use them to like get boost up in the areas. But if crap, I forgot that was there.
Yeah, another cheap death. But you can come at it from the other direction.
Yeah, that's what happens when I go around the wrong way. I thought I was being clever.
And by the way, that wise man there has pretty much spoken truth this entire episode.
Welcome to Gorg. You will die. For the record, Gorg, by the way, is actually the name of this asteroid that you're on. I don't know that we'll ever get far enough to actually discover this in the game, but the plot of this game is actually kind of interesting. In that it's not just... there I go dying again. It's not just you go into this asteroid and collect treasure. Like, the reason for the asteroid existing is actually kind of cool. The entire thing was originally basically a planetoid, and this society launched it as a seed ship. So all of the people on board this planetoid, like, they were basically supposed to be this next generation of colonists. And along the way, something went wrong, and they basically all decided they were going to start worshipping the computer on board instead of...
Wait, what just led you back there?
That stupid spike again.
I completely missed that.
Yeah. Now, do you find out what Gorg means, or is that... or stands for the, what do you call it? The... not anagram, but the...
acronym?
Thing. Acronym. That's that word. See,
I'm assuming you do, but like I say, I've never... gotten far enough to actually find out. I know that.
I was gonna say, it's one of those things where it's like, well, yeah, but it would require actually getting through all this and, you know, dealing with cheap deaths.
I can't even find any information on that on Google, so I guess that goes to show how many people were actually interested in this.
I'm trying to remember now where I actually read that.
Weasel, there's got to be a fan out there that's come up with some like fan fiction of this.
And I bet we're probably going to get a massive earful from them as soon as this hits the internet.
I was just going to say, wait until the video gets posted on YouTube, and then we'll find the angry fan. The one guy who was like, how dare you diss this game? This is the greatest side-scroller in the world, and...
I've seen that happen twice so far with things that I've been involved with.
If there is...
Although No. I was just going to say real quick that... Although, interestingly enough, there was no fan art, of Willie Beamish. So, there you go. Maybe there are certain games that aren't.
Not even his mom? I'm surprised.
That I was very surprised myself. That seemed like basically the kind of thing that would have, like, set off a bunch of kids. Anyway. Yeah, I'm going to keep this clean.
No matter what there is on the internet, someone somewhere likes it, no matter what.
That's true.
Yeah. What cracks me up, though, is the angry fan that I found, like, probably the one angry fan on the internet of Prime Target for the Macintosh. Even though I wrote a review of it and said that I actually kind of liked it, he saw fit to start yelling at me on my blog comments because I said the word senseless patriotism.
I remember seeing that comment.
But really, how else am I supposed to describe a full-motion video that's just panning over vistas of the Potomac and the Washington Monument while a snare drum and a trumpet are playing in the background?
Is it playing, like, Hail to the Chief, or...
No,
it
sounds like the kind of stuff you'd hear on, like, a CNN news show intro.
Ah.
Like, tonight in Congress.
So yeah, in case you were wondering, Bob, this is what the second level looks like.
It's basically the first level, but blue.
Yeah, pretty much.
And with angry bulldozers and geeks in glasses. Why are we
so
geeks in glasses?
I think those are computer engineers or something. But yeah, basically everything is trying to kill you. Why that might be the case, I'm not sure.
Well, your dude is trying to steal their stuff, isn't he?
Well, yeah, but...
It's like a home invasion. Just happens to be an asteroid home invasion. So I guess, like, law would be, like, in international waters, so it would be, like, totally cool to kill intruders.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, where there's no, like, stand your ground or whatever to deal with.
The space frontier is another one of those things, I think.
Yeah.
Just don't open fire on any Confederate vessels and you're probably fine.
Man.
But you're completely allowed to taunt them until they get angry at you and try to kill you. Then it's completely legal to shoot back. Can you guess I've been playing Privateer a lot recently?
So the other thing I want to point out, I was waiting for anybody else to mention this, but nobody has yet. How do you guys feel about the scrolling engine in this game?
Kind of terrible. You don't get very much field of view going on here.
Yeah, I think that's definitely a problem with, like, earlier you fell onto that brown spike after, like, right below here. It's like they don't give you enough time to react.
Yeah.
Well, actually, no, that wasn't below there, but there's another one like it a little later.
I think it's even worse in the CD version because they actually make the character walk faster.
Oh, jeez.
Which turns into kind of a disaster for the scrolling engine.
I don't want to go up there yet, that's where the exit is. I thought you said they made him walk slower.
Well, he walks faster, but his sprite is larger, so jumping is more of a pain.
That's right, yeah. But like I say, we'll get to
something
that,
so. Get into later. There's a very specific reason I bring it up, and I will have to bring it up again for that same specific reason.
Oops. Well, I answered my own question. The question being, do I really want to go up there? The answer was, no. least get my extra life back.
Boy. There's nothing worse than a mutual death.
I'm mad.
Well, what cracks me up too is, like, none of these enemies even have any obvious weaponry. All they have to do is touch you.
I can only assume that you're wearing some kind of reactive armor that's supposed to explode at the sign of any threat.
So the suit's defense mechanism vaporizes your head to protect you.
Yeah, I imagine he's got the armor on backwards.
That could be. I was gonna say maybe it's like the equivalent of those lizards that just drop their tails off and start bleeding whenever they whenever they're threatened, but
just melts your head instead.
See, I gotta say, at least this level's laid out in kind of a logical progression compared to the first level anyway.
On account of the broken music and the head exploding death, I found this game unnaturally creepy when I was a kid. I'm still not entirely sure why Dad would have tried it out, but then again, he did download an awful lot of really weird shareware games back in the 90s.
Well, that and the fact, you know, it's a small game, it's hosted on a BBS. Might as well grab it for the kids, right? I mean, how many of the Apogee games did we play? I think pretty much all of them.
Yeah, like, there were a couple that took us a while to actually find, but yeah, all of them.
So, the later CD release doesn't fix the music at all?
Not really. Like, there were a couple of tracks that I guess they resaved or something. But
so the devs completely ignored the issue.
Only, like, the title screen music actually works in the CD version.
Here's the
thing,
though.
I do... Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, one thing I do like is they leave behind corpses. I think that's kind of unique because, well, even in many games today, they just kind of... the enemies will blow up and disappear.
And, like, in Duke Nukem, which this game really obviously tries to pattern itself after, that just... they just kind of... fizzle out when
Holy
you shoot.
Crap, I actually almost didn't make that. Okay.
That was nice.
Yeah,
that was very
the way cool. the way those coins seem to work, can you save like right there before the spikes?
Ooh, you know what? Yeah, I'm gonna. I actually did make it, but.
Immediately.
Oh my god.
I keep forgetting how far behind I am on this.
I'm really glad I saved too, because I just got walked into by one of those stupid. There we go. Oh, that's nice.
Sorry about that.
No, you're good.
What did I miss?
Not much. I actually just made it down to the bottom part of the level, and now I'm gonna try and make it back up to where the exit is.
I think it would be wise to save scum this.
Yeah. I'm noticing they don't really distinguish between foreground and decorative elements very well.
Yeah.
This is a quick save with just per level.
Well, you
no,
can
it,
save
it actually does save mid-stage, believe it or not.
Yeah, like, you can save wherever you want, you just have to do it through the menu.
So that's another kind of a weird little oddity with this game, because that's not something that you saw in very many games at all, really.
I can only imagine the save files are comparatively larger than your average Apogee game save.
Probably, yeah. Oops. Ah, man. That's gonna be a fun area to try and get through. So I imagine this game would be a lot easier if there were any kind of, like, health items.
There are
no, there are no health items, and there's...
I swear that there was, like, a battery with an E on it, but
no,
it only gives one bar.
And it's only in the first level.
How are you supposed to avoid that?
That we've seen. Timing, I guess.
Don't.
You have to spend hours perfecting a dodge between the two fireballs, and like you're forbidden from playing anything else until you've learned how to dodge those.
Oh my god, are you freaking kidding me? I literally was on the exit pad. There's another teleporter up there though, so I'm wondering maybe I'm supposed to teleport from somewhere else.
Hang on a sec.
Some of these ramps do you can shoot to flip them, but not all of them. Oh, this is a secret area. Wow, that. Okay.
That's some secret. Points, a bottle of suspicious yellow thing.
Yeah, a bottle of suspicious liquid.
And another one of those glasses geeks.
Pretty sure that the help file says that they're like computer engineers or something.
Oh, okay. That was for his random drug test.
I also noticed that it was bubbling.
Okay, let's try this again. Ah, crap. Nope. I'm pretty positive that this game is just designed to infuriate you.
And there's no way to blow those turrets, is there?
Uh-uh. You cannot kill them.
It seems to me like they just didn't even bother putting any thought into the map design.
I'm honestly wondering if they playtested this at all.
They did, that's why I think they canceled it.
Yeah, I think they might have actually submitted it mostly complete to Apogee, and then Apogee decided it wasn't good enough and it would take them too long to fix it.
Yeah.
That wouldn't surprise me.
I'm actually kind of wondering if this is an attempt to make quick buck or not, because no person with good conscience could actually release this.
The only thing I can think of is that maybe these guys were just like wizards at it, and so they figured, oh yeah, this will be fine.
See, that's the thing. I wonder if that happens. You know, where they just don't get playtesters from, I guess, far enough away from the development pool.
Yeah, it could be. Okay, let me give this one more try. One more try. And then I will jump to the CD version. Oops, I'm going the wrong way. These blue caves are so confusing.
Blue.
This is like a, in terms of a premise, this game is basically Broken Firehawk.
See, like, you can't even, like, duck or anything to get out of the way of those lasers. You just, if you can't jump over it, you just take the hit.
All right, now, is this a CD version?
This is going to be the CD version, yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
So notice this actually lets you set a sound card for actual sound. You'll see that in a little bit here.
I have to wonder what a life-size enhancer is.
A life-size enhancer?
Should I Google it?
Microporum.
I have a bad feeling about this.
Gore.
I have a feeling that it might bring up something bad.
Sound card to the mix here.
Okay, that's probably a good idea.
No, I'm not hearing. Oh, that's right, because I turned it off. Notice the title screen music is back to its old glitchy self. So let's check out the story now, shall we? Maybe they've cleaned up the art somewhat, made it a little better. Not exactly. As a matter of fact, here's the best part of this. The CD itself of this game is about 50 megs or so in size. That's all the space it takes up. And the entirety of that, besides the game itself, which is only like a meg and a half, 2 or 3 megs, I think, and most of that being graphics, what takes up all of the space on the CD version is the animations that they did for the story. And as you can see, they didn't change hardly any of the graphics for it at all. They literally just animated it into an FLI format and then played it straight off the CD.
That is some amazing artwork.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh god. Dude looks like a strung-out lobster on crack. With a mop on his head.
Yeah, he definitely looks like he's, he really needs to, like, cover up and wear some sunscreen because, you know, it's gonna catch up to him.
Yeah. Alright, so first thing you're gonna notice here...
Collect 100 coins for extra man.
Okay,
man,
besides man. The geeky voice reading over the, tips.
Welcome to Gorg.
Yeah, he's now a budget Asper in the wire.
Your character is way tall.
Now, obviously, he's animated a little better.
Collect.
But they also kind of, like, stripped him of what little character he had.
Also, Doom Guy.
Recharge. Collect key.
The one improvement I can definitely say that they made, though, remember where that spike was right here? That's not there now.
Oh, cool.
So now they have had somebody play test it, apparently.
Now, can he shoot at an angle?
Yes.
Oh, okay. That I don't remember seeing him do that in the vanilla version. Could he do it that there? Or?
He does in that one. I just never actually had an excuse to use it.
Oh, okay,
there's
gotcha.
There's also a new completely useless prone feature.
Oh.
Well, you can't move while you're laying down. You can just shoot things.
Wait, can you shoot? Hang on, can you shoot while you're in prone?
It's down and forward to do that.
Ah, there we go. Ah, you can shoot in prone mode. Okay. No, that actually I could see having a use.
Some of that walk animation looks off to me. I think it looks too good for this game.
It's not being played back fast enough, so it looks like he's running on the moon.
He's kind of
swimming pool.
Yeah.
If you've ever tried to run in a swimming pool, that's what it looks like doing.
Just waiting for molasses.
Walking through deep snow. That's kind of... No, so he's got this, looks like he stole Electro Man's helmet.
Yep. And his Wi-Fi is acting up too. You notice how it keeps blinking? The little antenna there?
Uh-oh. Yeah, I was gonna say, some people just can't handle their Wi-Fi.
Transport to other areas.
I know what you're referring to, and I think it best that we not continue further down.
Oh, no, I'm just saying that, like, sometimes... I can't set up a Wi-Fi on the DS. That was one of the reasons why I never did, like, DLC missions on Dragon Quest IX. It was because I could never figure out... Well, I mean, I could figure out, but it was just really hard to get Wi-Fi set up on the DS for...
Oh.
I forget what... Like, the encoding or the encryption on that one was, like, this one type, and, like, every other... device I've ever used, like, did not have that much of a pain in the butt to get started, so.
Hey, X.
Yes, sir.
Can I send you another game from these people?
Is it Rollo Gump?
Yes.
Good, yes. Please.
It's gonna be 300 megs, is it okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
I will Dropbox it right now.
Okay, so the only evidence that I can find of this weird sound card called the Life Size Enhancer is apparently it's one of those weird Kovox clones, so it's like a parallel port sound adapter thing.
Okay.
It doesn't come with speakers, so you have to hook it up to an actual stereo system.
Okay, so you guys remember this gap here, right? That's the gap that you have to get across in order to get to the exit.
And the kicker is that it doesn't even look like a gap. There's even a torch sitting on it.
Yeah, they do that a lot, the weird sort of illusory... It's background,
wow.
But it's not really background. But
that's
here's
not
the thing.
Cool.
Yeah, your character can no longer actually jump across it.
Yeah, I swear, I tried this jump, like, 20-plus times, and not once did I ever manage to get across that. I was very close, but still just slipped right off.
Because here's the thing. See... The way that his sprite... Let me back up here.
Wow, that's some
so
really
way,
great work
the
on
way that his sprite
part.
Is, his toe just barely sticks off the edge, and if you move even a pixel farther to the left, straight down. So yeah, we didn't even get as far as testing out the second level in this one, because there's not a way to get to it. Now, let me,
oh my gosh.
Let
it's
see
like,
something. Is
here,
there...
Here's the thing. They may have made this level impossible, but I'm kind of imagining that level 2 will be a little easier on account of being able to actually lay down to avoid those bullets.
Yeah, we'd actually be able to get to the exit then. So, since that one's a wash, and we can't actually just warp to the second episode in that, actually, to be honest, I don't know if that version has the second and third episodes or not. It may only have been a remake of the first episode.
Yeah.
Who even knows at this point?
But, since we I do have copies of the second and third episode of Gateworld, we'll go back to that. Oh, whoops, I forgot to do the story, actually. Let's do that first. Because now you can find out. Traveling for 2 weeks from the site of the Gorg asteroid's destruction. So, yeah, you killed all these lovely people on their seed ship. We're not sure why, but...
Also, your ship is called the Klondike Guppy. I have no idea if that even means anything. And, of course, reusing this really terribly... airbrushed picture of Captain Buzz Klondike.
I'm getting the feeling that this was done in deluxe paint.
Probably.
Yeah. Because I know for a while that was like the tool to have too, if you were a game dev. So.
Yeah, I am noticing the yank that one font from deluxe paint elsewhere. The one that the early Mortal Kombat games also really liked.
Oh, here's the other graphic that you get to see of your character. Apparently he only has hair on his forehead.
Right.
It's like cheekbones are terrifying. Like.
Well, at least they kept that horrifying nose consistent between both.
I think that's his hand.
Oh, maybe. I don't know.
Doesn't account for the red hair. Thing, so.
I see he looks like cracked out like that.
Probably because the only sleep he gets is when he's on ice. By that I mean cryogenic sleep. Not.
Yeah.
Not some futuristic science fiction drug. If I actually meant that, I would say he's on tech.
Take tech and die. Also, watch the GC9X livecast, Tech War. It's amazing. And that's another terrible game.
Well, I was going to say, that's another terrible game that involves bizarre jumping things that kind of... Instead of these, instead of these little seesaws, you have the hobos to jump off of.
Yeah. Kel's picture on that was amazing, though, too. It's like, totally not Tony Hawk ramp jumping off of random dudes.
So now we have this lovely long corridor that you can't get in and out of without getting attacked by one of those stupid laser turrets.
That hurts a lot.
This game just has fantastic design.
I imagine they made it look good before they actually made it play good. And then they never quite finished with that.
Yeah, but they didn't even do that with this one, because look at the background. Like, okay, yeah, it's incredibly detailed, but because it scrolls at the same rate you do, you can't hardly tell what's going on. As it's so busy back there, it's like...
Yeah. At least Gorg had the virtue of making, like, parallaxing backgrounds. Also, random blonde lady that you were totally just shooting at would probably kill you if you touched her.
Yeah.
Just like real life.
I'm calling my lawyer!
For some reason, all that's coming to mind is that episode of King of the Hill where Bobby takes the women's self-defense course.
Oh dear. God dang it, Bobby. Only 8 a.m. and all worded up.
Have they actually changed the gun so that you only fire one bullet at a time now?
No, it's you actually have to pick up a power-up before it does the two-shot.
Oh. Okay, so it's just that I'd never tried firing the gun without picking up something first.
I'm still trying to figure out, though, why one of the things that you pick up for money or for points is pretzels.
It'll explain the bottles of foaming yellow liquid, too.
Oh, yeah.
It was another one of those weird shareware staples, picking up just random stuff for points.
These kids didn't have anything to do with pretzel pee, did they?
No, unfortunately. Thank goodness for that. No, but, like, I'm just thinking of, like, the ones in Secret Agent Man alone are just ridiculous, because you're picking up for points pairs of sunglasses, bottles of toothpaste, file folders, books, the letters S, P, and Y, because of course you have to spell something out to get an awesome bonus.
Well, I mean, the books and the floppy disks and the files and stuff, you know, that all makes sense, because... You know, you're collecting information. You're a spy, that's what you do. But...
And then there's, like, candy and teddy bears and cans of Pepsi and everything else that Commander Keen did.
Yeah.
And then at some point they changed out the extra life-giving items to bottles of what they called Vitalin.
Oh, there goes my head. Well, that doesn't give you an extra life. That just gives you a really cool first one. Okay, so just because I'm curious now, and I haven't actually looked at this one yet. Wait, is that a...
Episode 3?
That's actually a decent-looking giant sprite of the main character. I approve.
Which only further goes to prove my theory that he just has a permanent dopey grin on his face.
Maybe it's like he's got, like facial paralysis from the, hypersleep or...
Previously on Gateworld. It
almost looks different that... It's the same drawing. Well, okay, look at his hair, though. Did it have that, like, it looked like they smudged it or screwed up?
Yeah.
The hair texture or filling?
Yeah, I think they messed it up when they moved it over or something. Like, they moved
part
of it, but
selected,
the rest of it...
Yeah. Yeah.
So are we going into, like, virtual reality gaming for riches now?
I'm thinking so.
I can't even read half this text, it's so blurry.
I know, it's terrible.
And dark.
And it's all in all caps in Westminster font.
Okay.
Now, blue just doesn't compress well.
I want to point something out. This area right here, this is one of the screenshots that you see in the please register view. This is literally the first level of the third episode. So they didn't even, like, go far into the game to get the screenshot. They just said, eh, we'll start the third episode and take a screenshot. And then they'll think it's good enough.
Yeah. One thing that I can say as a positive about this game, though, is that compared to Duke Nukem, at least they didn't rip tile graphics from Turrican.
Okay.
Because that's just wrong.
What? But you know, if you're gonna rip off something, you better rip off something good, at least.
And then I also discovered, like, last week, that, you know those wooden crates in Duke Nukem that we also saw in PC Mega Man?
Yeah.
Well, guess which game got released first?
PC Mega Man?
Yep.
I know they sold sound effects from Super Castlevania 4 and Duke Nukem 2.
Yep. So, at least Duke Nukem has a storied history of borrowing things.
Piracy. If you like.
Yeah, man, I mean, deluxe paint is expensive.
Oh, Gumstein.
Respecting copyrights is for wimps.
Yeah, it's downloading on my side, so...
And then, like... Yeah... And then, of course, there's that well-publicized mini-feud between Duke Nukem and Bruce Campbell.
Oh, yeah.
So... Oh my god, that is the stupidest thing ever. Okay, you remember the energy canisters that give you health, right?
Yeah.
Those are G canisters. Which look exactly like the energy canisters, but they have a G on them, and they're purple. Do you know what they give you?
And they just... points.
Yeah. So if you weren't paying attention, you'd get your hopes up and go, no, but I wanted health, not points.
Well, at least this game hasn't committed the cardinal sin of Super Mario Bros. 2 for super players, and that's making health items that kill you.
Okay, yeah, that's true. They'll save that job for the spikes.
No, but seriously, like, we might know the lost levels and how the poison mushrooms got turned to this weird, sickly blue-purple. In the Famicom version, it was not that obvious.
They were still actually the same colors?
They were kind of like the Korean knockoff of mushrooms.
Oh, man.
They're still that orange and red color scheme, it's just the red is very slightly darker on the poison ones.
So,
yeah, you can in fact die because you were expecting a health item.
I'm gonna be honest, so far this is actually the best level I've played in this game.
No, that's not hard.
I don't know if it's Stockholm Syndrome or not, but I could actually enjoy this episode.
Well, do you think that they just developed them in order and then they maybe learned a little bit from them? But that would then kind of open the question of what happened with the CD version.
Well, the CD version, from what I can tell, was worked on by a different company. Because it was,
yeah.
It was released by Microform, and I don't think it even mentions Homebrew.
Yeah, like Homebrew Software's name I don't think is even mentioned anywhere. You know what, I'm actually going to go corroborate this myself while you're doing that.
Yeah, because I was trying to find information on some stuff like that, because I know Microforum used to pick up, like, a lot of shareware games back in the day, and then they would re-release them on CD or whatever. Because that Game Empire Collection CD, I know we had a bunch of stuff on there that, like, we'd never heard of before, even.
Okay, I am now in my Gord folder. Let's run GG help.
Oh, that's not gonna tell you much.
Oh, okay, so that just gives me command line information.
Yeah.
What's in here?
There's not really any documentation or anything in that version. Shoot, I didn't even find out that these guys were former Epix developers until I found the readme in the original Gateworld. I didn't mention that before because that's going to be part of the intro, but the two main guys that worked on this, Ken Rogaway and David Farquharson, were formerly developers that worked for Epix. Like, they actually worked on various personal computer ports of some of their more popular games.
Oh, cool.
Okay, so the only credits that Gorg is going to give me... Oh, there's actually several pages of this. Okay. So we've got... Edge Creations Incorporated are credited for art direction, backdrops, and level design. Character artwork by Adam M. Burton of Edge Creations. Additional art by Soft Scene. And it keeps scrolling automatically and I keep missing these. Music by Prosonus. But no mention of Homebrew Software, but the original two authors were at least in the credits.
So maybe by that point, Homebrew Software had kind of, like, dissolved? I don't know, because I'm trying to remember what the last game was that was listed by them in Moby Games.
Further, I'm going to go have a look at something here.
Because I want to say Rollo Gunk was like 95 or 94, wasn't it?
Not exactly able to look at that yet. Let's see. Folders, Game Empire, catalog. I'm now going to look at the Microforum catalog.
Okay. I mean, how do you guys feel about this game? I mean, you think with maybe a little bit of love and care, you think it could have made a decent game, or...
Yeah, I think if they would have... I don't know, like, I think if they would have let you take a few more hits and...
maybe definitely made the hazards actually avoidable.
Yeah, I think that... I do agree with you about the field of vision. They should have either made your sprite a little smaller or something. I don't know, like, maybe slowed down your descent or...
I don't know. Like,
as far as Gorg goes, if they hadn't messed with the jump mechanics and made your sprite as big as it was, that probably would have been the definitive version, if such a thing could be created.
I don't know, really. It's like, without all the problems, it's not. It's, even without all its problems, it's not going to be good for like Duke Nukem 2 or anything. It's just, it's kind of unremarkable, really, at best.
Yeah, being ho hum was the best case scenario here, to be honest.
What about something on... Okay, has anyone gone in and done, like, a ROM hack or edit, like, to fix something like this?
Not to my knowledge. I think the most I can say is that my friend looked at all of the XMI files for music and determined them to be corrupted.
Right. I'm just kind of wondering, like, did they all use their own, you know, like, action games like this or... whatever, did they use a compiler or something? I mean, was there something common between them, or did they all just kind of use proprietary like software?
It really depends, but there were... There were some libraries available back in the day. I know a lot of people, I think, tend to use Borland Pascal or Turbo C++ in the time.
Yeah.
Or Turbo C or whatever they were using. But aside from that, I think most people just tended to run their own, so to speak.